For centuries, we have known that knowledge is power. And today, knowledge is more accessible than ever. We now own phones with more data than what was needed to send astronauts to the moon. However, with all that knowledge comes a lot of noise, and the human mind can only process so much. Enter data scientists who find the logic in large sums of information and make it accessible for the rest of us. The key is how we use that data, to inform or to influence. UM's internationally recognized professor, Alberto Ciro, is exploring this dilemma.
I've always had a passion for communication. I consider myself a translator. I like to take scientific knowledge, knowledge that is generated by experts in different fields, and I like to transform that knowledge into messages that the public can understand. There has been an explosion in the use of visuals to communicate information and more specifically data to the public. In the past decade or decade and a half, there has been a substantial increase in the appearance of maps and graphs and charts. Through their analytics, organizations are seeing that the public really likes to see that type of product. Some of the most popular stories ever published are data visualizations. Data is numbers. The ultimate test as to whether a visualization is good or bad is whether that visualization is understood. If it is not understood, it doesn't really matter that you apply the principles well. I mean, the principle is that you need to inform someone of something. If that doesn't work, then the graphic doesn't work. There is an increasing awareness of the value to communicate information to other people, but also to analyze the information. A graph, a diagram, a map, they are not just communication tools, they are also reasoning tools. There is an ethical responsibility for every citizen to care about the quality of the informational environment that we live in. When we present visually information that is good to the public and we inform the public, we can help people make better decisions and better choices. And there is something good about that, ethically good about that.
You might think that big data is something unique to math and science, but data science and the humanities intersect in many ways. No matter where you come from, there's one universal language we all understand, music. When you hear a good song, you and everyone in the room might start tapping to the beat or singing along. Professor Mitsunori Yukihara is mining music data to understand the science behind how music connects with us all.
My interest in music data comes in two parts. One part is classifying music. Can a computer listen to CDs in the digital form, zeros and ones? And can it say, hey, this is jazz music? Oh, this is a relaxing music. So can we use a computer for automatic classification? The second important question I'm asking is by understanding data and how humans listen to music, can we make a good way of recommending music? By saying, hey, you liked this piece 1 month ago and you listened to it ad nauseam. Maybe it's time for you to listen to it again. You can use a audio signal processing on acoustic data to extract some information. Computer science and data science is about solving problems. If there is data to tackle some questions in your topic, that is sort of a marriage made in heaven. So that is probably the reason that I've been doing music data mining.
The data we collect is almost always about something that already happened. But what makes data extremely valuable is when it can tell us what's about to happen, predicting the future. It's a skill none of us have quite mastered on our own, but Professor Benjamin Kurtman is making progress, saving the planet and saving lives.
When I talk to people about where we're going with data science, I can't begin to tell you how exciting. We're at the beginning of just a revolution in how we understand the way the weather and climate system works, and that revolution is being driven by how we're able to interpret data from the past. I can imagine a future where we can talk about the flood risk at your house. We're going to be able to talk about extreme weather at your house, besides just the whole Southeast US. I think that's going to change how people live and work. The biggest challenge in hurricane forecasting right now is the intensity. That intensity really depends on the details of how the ocean and the atmosphere talk to each other. But this revolution in data science is going to make it possible for us to do the talking much better, to really mine the data so that we get much better intensity forecasts. Our niche at the University of Miami is solving pragmatic problems, making sure that decisions are based on the best available evidence. We have state-of-the-art technology. Our supercomputer is specifically designed to do problems in data science. It's the first one of its kind in that respect. So the students, not only are you getting hands-on real experience, but you're getting hands-on real experience with cutting-edge technology to test that theory that you get in the classroom. Warning people about hazards, if you can give them more warning about a coming hazard, you can save lives, save property, you do some good in society. That's really what's driven me over the years and still drives me today.
If there's one thing you can clearly see, is the University of Miami's Master of Science in Data Science program can prepare you for a range of very diverse careers. From politics to music to climate change, students like me are encouraged to not only learn data science skills, but to apply them in a field that interests us. Here at UM, we truly embrace the notion of data science for all, empowering the next generation of innovators, big thinkers, and problem solvers.